trembling under the crashing waves, to step out of my comfort zone into the realm of the unknown, where Jesus is and he's holding out his hand. But the waves are calling out my name and they laugh at me, reminding me of all the times I tried before and failed. The way they keep on telling me time and time again, boy, you never win, you never win. But the voice of truth tells me a different story. The voice of truth says do not be afraid. And the voice of truth says this is for my glory. Out of all the voices calling out to me, I will choose to listen and believe the voice of truth. Oh, what I would do to have the kind of strength it takes to stand before a giant, with just a sling and a stone, surrounded by the sound of a thousand warriors shaking in their armor, wishing they'd have had the strength to stand. But the giant's calling out my name and he laughs at me, reminding me of all the times I tried before and failed. The giant keeps on telling me time and time again, boy, you'll never win, you'll never win. But the voice of truth tells me a different story. The voice of truth says do not be afraid. And the voice of truth says this is for my glory. Out of all the voices calling,
preach is an awesome, awesome experience to do this, but it's also an awesome responsibility. And I don't take this lightly. And it's kind of uncomfortable, to be honest with you. I mean, you might think, well, he talks all the time. No, it is very uncomfortable, because I'm bringing before you what I feel God has put on my heart. Now, a few things I have learned through not necessarily being mentored day by day, but I believe I'm being mentored by our pastor. We spent a great amount of time kicking it, conversating, throwing stuff off the wall, and that's Jesus stuff. And I call it a privilege to be under him. I don't know about y'all, I do. This wasn't how I was supposed to open. But I count it a privilege to be in this body. I really do. Because I love everyone God has crossed paths with here. Do I like everything you do? No. You probably don't like everything I do. But it really doesn't matter. I struggled here in trying to get this together, but Pastor always told me one thing. When you do something, relate it to the people that you're going through. The last 2 weeks for me have been a roller coaster. The message will be titled Choices, but for real life, I had to make some choices this week. They were not easy. And it was a slot of 2 weeks that I had to deal with these choices. I bounced it off my wife, of course, first. I think that's the first and foremost thing you do. She bounced it back to me, threw it back in my court, and said, well, if God's telling you to do that, I'm going to say what you say, honey. I said, what's that? Trust God, and I'm in your corner no matter the decision. And I said, okay. But I had him play that song because the voice of truth always tells me a different story, but I found out there are other voices always calling out. And as soon as she agreed with me, those other voices were calling out. Does she really mean that? Is she really in your corner? Does she really care? And it's a hard thing to distinguish what you are to do when you're faced with that. And here's the funny part for me. I said, well, I make choices all the time, but I'm going to call on Sonny. And then I thought, Sonny's camping somewhere. I wanted him bad. I couldn't just make this. It's impossible for me to make this decision myself. I had to go through Pastor first, and then I feel really, you know, you feel really good. You talk to Pastor, you come out. But know what? I found an exciting thing out. When you make choices, generally, the choices should be made between you and God. You know what? I needed Sonny, but God wanted me to recognize that I needed him more. And as I recognized my need for God, I still attempted it in my own way. I called my nephew because we kick it all the time. And nothing. Call brother Scott. I got me a brother in the body. He's going to give me some good old information. Couldn't get him at right away. Poor brother Scott headed down to Milwaukee to take off to go to California. Then if I finally realize, it's a choice. I want to try to leave with you guys today. We have choices, but God wants those choices to be made in our lives based off of three things that he's dealing with me about. And those three things are, he wants us to make the right choices to change our lives. He wants us to make the right choices to change our families' lives. And he also wants us to make the right choices to change a nation. Let's just get off the nation, because that might seem so insurmountable in your natural mind. But he wants to make a change in this community. The problem is, do we choose to make a choice to believe that he can do that through us? And Mr. Joseph of the Bible in the Old Testament has been ping-ponging in my spiritual brain for about 3 weeks now. But there's one statement made in Genesis that involves Joseph. When he was taken down to Egypt, and I believe it is the 39th chapter, verse 2 of Genesis. If you'd like to go there, go there. It probably won't be a lot of scripture that I'll take you to. It'll probably be you having to tolerate hearing me out. But sometimes hearing out is good. I'm not of the quality of some pastors or whatever you want to say who preach to you. I'm not trying to come to you with influencing words. I'm not trying to come to you to woo you. I'm not trying to come to you to make you feel like, wow, he's got it going, because I don't. If you want to talk about choices in my life, most of them I made were on my own, and guess what? They weren't good. However, there have been plenty of choices that I made tuned in with God. But here's my problem. The ones that I have made, tuning in with God, I could see clearly where he wanted me to go. But sometimes outside influences, sometimes friends, sometimes situations, sometimes my emotions, sometimes my feelings, sometimes my mental capacity gets in the way. And guess what? God is over there, and I ain't choosing a choice with involving him. When I know well, he says, the Lord, I'm with you always. Is that not what he told us? Even till the what? Ends of the world. I will never leave you or what? Wow. Do I really believe that? Do you really believe that? Well, as we were talking about Joseph here, Joseph recognized one thing as he was captured in Israel. And God made it clear that God was with Joseph. Now, isn't that wonderful? Would you agree? Isn't that wonderful? How many of you would raise your hand and say, God is with you? You feel that all the time? Huh? And we got it going from the New Testament, from what I understand. We don't have to wait to hear him actually talk to us. Jesus has laid it out for us, and then he gave us the Holy Spirit as a representation to constantly be there with us to tell us that God is what? So I broke it down and says, Leon, God is with you. God is with you. God is with you. You have to choose to believe that. Or you can choose not to believe it. So as I did this, I thought about some choices men have made, and we have many. And our father Abraham made some brilliant choices, but he also made some bonehead choices. That's Abraham. Yeah? The guy he said that would nation all of us, bring all his people into this whole mix. One of his greatest choices he made was, and I don't know if we really get this, going up to the mountain, taking his son along with him for a sacrifice. My mind kind of wandered for a second there. Well, let me tell you why I wondered. as I read that, and I spent, I don't know, 2-3 hours, maybe even more yesterday, all day reading. As I'm reading the story, I'm saying, I don't see any indication that he went back and told his wife. None. Got up, did what God said do, got on the move, and moved out. Now, we don't need to suppose what his wife would have said if she says, hey, I'll take back there. I want you to take your little boy. Honey, God told me to take him up on the hill, lay him out. She ain't gonna have that. She's on the phone right now. Come get him. It ain't going to work. But he did not tell his wife. And he stepped out. And he did not tell anyone else. And the amazing thing about that is he had 3 days' journey to think about that. Am I making the right choice? Oh, God, are you positive that this is the right choice? Come on. I got to actually take my son, make the right. Is that the right choice? We usually use lambs for this, you know? That's how we usually do it. Is this the right choice? Well, certainly it was. We know the story as he proceeded up to the mountain to sacrifice his son. And it's not without, to me, it's not without entertainment, because his son said, hey, Dad,
what?
I've seen you do this quite a few times when we worship God together, when we do a sacrifice. Where is the lamb? That's what Isaac asked him. Where's the lamb? And he just simply said, God will provide. But what amazed me is that Isaac did not freak out. Isaac didn't panic. Isaac did not go into a frenzy, which I think my son would have been like, you crazy. If I thought about tying him up and he saw that, it just would not. It wasn't going to work with him. He'd be screaming. Here's my point. As Isaac got there and did all he was told to do and raised his arm to do the final job, God spoke to him then. See, we want God to speak right now. I would rather for him to say, make this choice, and it's clear. And I bet you thought that too, coming up here from California. But guess what? You couldn't make that choice without talking to Carrie. It was not going to be made. You told me. She had to be on board. Yeah, Carrie, you would have liked to see like a little more wider at first, didn't you? You wanted to see, we got to, oh, honey, I'm going up there, and this is the same type of job I can get, and I could still. Didn't make sense. Doesn't make sense. God, why do that? Because that's the kind of God I serve. He likes to take the lowly, uneducated, rejected, confused, disappointing people, and he likes to raise them up to a level where none of us can refute it. But we all have to make choices to deal with that. And from that, I can see that Abraham's choice was an excellent choice, but on the other hand, he turned around and he got married. Which he was married, and he had a wife, and her name was Sarah, and she couldn't have kids. But another choice came into play, and I'm just running you through it, that his wife Sarah said, look, we need some kids. I want you to marry my handmaiden. I believe her name was Hagar. Now, this same God that supplied on the mount could have supplied Abraham right then to say to her, no. But somehow, some way, he decided to make that. To me, that's a boneheaded choice. And let me tell you why it's so boneheaded. It not only happened with him, it passed on through his entire family. The three guys that we're told to talk about, to think about is Abraham, Isaac, and who? Do you know Abraham had his first son? Y'all know who his first son was? Ishmael. Didn't it say through Ishmael? Did you know Jacob had two sons? It talked about one, but it didn't talk about the other. You know which one they didn't talk very much about? Esau. But Abraham's sons, Isaac, Jacob, all went through similar things. It just blew me away. It was so similar that I found out that Sarah said, I don't want Isaac to marry into the tribe of Canaan. So she sent, or they arranged for him to go to their families. He found a wife in the household of her family. And guess what? As I kept reading, Jacob went exactly to the same household. How did I figure it out? Laban, the brother. Laban, now the uncle. I believe I might be saying that right. And he married from the same group. God has a purpose. And what were those guys by nature? I guess you could say they were kind of farmer guys. Can you relate? Huh? They dealt with a lot of cattle, Steve. Yeah, they did. They weren't all that bright. They weren't all that educated. I'm not saying you're not, though. You went to college, so we know you're good. But I'm just letting you know, it's not in whom you think you are. It's whom you are. It's him who makes us and leads us and directs us. And I thought choices could be, you know, there's some choices in life, common sense choices. I cut my finger, I put a Band-Aid on. But there are some choices in life you need to stop daily and recognize that God's with you every day. Now, I had to stop that. I mean, you mean every day? He means every day. When I make decisions, I'm making them with the Holy Spirit present. We just heard about it with Brother Clark up top. Have you made any decisions with the Holy Spirit there, Clark, that were not offline, but didn't do it right? All your decisions good with the Holy Spirit? Because he recognizes that the Spirit is with him. We don't. We have issues. We have problems. Believing that God can be with us every day. Let death come into the family. It's gone. What's your choice then? You're going to choose to believe or hear all the other voices? What? Calling out, because they will. How about your kid not growing up and doing the things you want? I'm going through that right now with my son. I want him to be perfect, and God says, nope. Ain't happening. I'm doing everything right. I think I am anyway. I'm doing it right. I'm trying to raise him up the way he should be raised up. But he has choices he has to make. I can't control those. I can't even touch those. What I can do, however, is pray. Even though I told you some of the negatives of these men, one thing I did pick up in reading through all this is that they had a time that they fellowshiped with God, worshiped, did something. It wasn't just them trying to do it themselves. It was actually them communicating with God to keep this thing going. The moment you feel like you don't need to talk to God about an issue or a situation to make a choice in something, let me tell you. Pastor gave us a scripture that says, and I'm not even going to repeat it, What was the scripture base that Pastor gave us the last 4 or 5 weeks? Everybody know it? Say it again. And where did that come from? 3:11. Right? Y'all believe that? You can't start anything except on the foundation of Jesus Christ. Y'all believe that? Here's the real question. Do we live like that? How many of you can say, I live like that every day? I can. But it's a learning curve. I want to learn how to make choices daily. I don't want to leave God out of my choices. I want him in my choices. Are they going to always turn out like I want them to be? No. Is it always lead up like I want it? What if the guys decided to go to the Red Sea and the priest said, we're not moving? But they chose to take that step into a river that looked like, all those things that go with that. And when they step, what's no problem for everybody else? Everybody else said, oh, let's go. But when they got to the other side, choices had to be made. What's the detriment of that? An age group, as we have heard over and over, from 20 and what? Up. What happened to them? They died. And the age group from 20 and down sort of took over the new realms of this thing. Choices. What's so big about choices? A lot is big about choices. Now, in Jacob's old life, with his two wives, Leah and Sonny had to help me out. I got you. Sonny had to help me because I kept calling Rebecca. I had it all mixed up. He says, Leland, get it right by him. He helped me out there, but it's Leah and Rachel. He got duped into the first one, if you want to say that. You know, she had a lot of babies. She said in her mind, I got my man now. He ain't going nowhere. I'm good. But her man was still hooked on who? Rachel. One he came for. One he wanted to be with. One he wanted to share his life with. So it became so messed up because of their choices that these two girls started battling, passing him off. Wow. Would you hand your husband over to another guy? I don't think so. I mean, another gal. Oh, my Lord, I didn't say that. I did. To another gal? No, you wouldn't. Under no circumstance. Well, that was that time. What? Still, under no circumstance. Their hearts to be with one man is just like it is now. They had no intention for their husband to go out and have multi-wives. Period. May have been what the culture did, but that wasn't what they felt like they should do. And as we see them go on, we see these kids born not only to the two girls that were given to him by way of him working for them, but to servant girls. And as I realize, that's a dysfunctional unit here. God went into a dysfunctional unit and had a purpose. Do you realize that? Because them brothers, they were all crazed. Simeon, Reuben, they were all crazed. Those guys were off the hook crazy. Then comes Pepsqueak, Joseph, the 17-year-old, the dreamer. And his daddy made it clear to them, that's my what? That's my boy. I gave him a coat. And his brothers what? Envied? Got mad? Got all upset? That never happens in my family. We don't get it. We don't envy each other. We don't get mad. We don't have arguments, do we, Gage? We never have arguments. We don't have discussions. Okay, all right. All right. Okay, that's enough from you. He claims we have arguments all the time. And he's probably right. But the point I'm trying to make is they were dysfunctional people as far as I'm concerned. But God chose to go into that situation and make a change. Well, like I told you, there's 3 points I'd like to talk about. I just try to give you a synopsis of this craziness between all these families, and there are probably much more I could have said, but number one in life, God wants to change our lives to be dependent on Him at all times. Not dependent sometimes, not dependent a little bit, not dependent most of the time, all the time. In Him alone. So we can be transformed into, we heard Sonny talk about that a couple of weeks ago, the likeness of Him. Are we going to be just like Christ? No. But we're striving to be transformed into the likeness of Him. How can I be transformed to the likeness of Him if I'm not dependent on Him? Because if I do it any other way, I'm going to be transformed into the likeness of what I like about myself. And I don't like myself. Now, don't get me wrong. I love me because Christ loves me. But I know what I'm capable of. I know in a blink of an eye I can make a decision to destroy what God has started in my life, as well as I know in a blink of an eye I can continue to walk out what God has walked out, is doing in my life. I know that. I'm not unaware of that. But sometimes we build ourselves up so much and become so dependent on where we are and what steps and levels we are. And talking about choices, when I heard Brother's choice over there about his motorcycle, I went, wow. Not because he sold his motorcycle. It was excruciating, was it not? Did you just go ahead and say, oh, yes, Lord, take my bike? No.
No, he did not.
He had trouble. But he made what? Made the choice. He made the right choice. And not that God rewarded you is important to me or not. You made the right choice. And somewhere down the line, that choice is going to affect your boys, whether you know it or not. That's going to come back to them and say, my dad made the right choice. That's what I'm talking about choices for. Not for me. I want my son someday to make the right choices. And I hope it's based off me making right choices. Again, do I make them all the time? No. No. So we see that God wants to change us to be transformed in His likeness. And to do that, we need to make choices that will live up to His word. Here's some people that encountered choices that made a difference in their lives. Would you agree that the woman at the well had to make a choice that day? How many of you don't agree that she had to make a choice? Not only did she make a choice, but let me tell you, as I stated it, life, family, and a nation, as soon as she made that choice, where did she go? And she told those people, and those people said, what? Who is this guy? What is he about? Let me go find him. So she was off and running because God made a change in her life, and she needed to make a change in others. Well, you need scripture to back that up. I believe that's in John 4:14. We'll find that encounter. Would you not agree that Job had to make choices? Hard ones. Got his wife screaming in his ear. crazy man, curse the Lord and get it over with. Huh? She was on him. He had three buddies that just stayed on him. Rode him and tried to break him. But his integrity and his choice to serve God never, ever came into an attack. His physical body did. What he went through did. But what he felt for God never came under attack. He still stood. He withstood the storm. How many of us are withstanding the little easy storms we have? How many of us are really a lot relying? But Job had a dish full. And then would we not agree? We talked about him this morning up in the upper classroom. How about Paul? Did Paul have to make a decision? His decision at one time, or a choice? His choice was, this is the way I do it. But God said, no, this is the way I want you to do it. Will you make a choice? And guess what? Paul made that choice on the road of Damascus. Didn't change his style of dealing with what he dealt with, just made the right choice, recognizing that God was with him. And God is likewise with us all. It's our choice to accept that. And then I think about my friend that makes me laugh all the time when I think about him, Mr. Nicodemus, snuck in by night. My theory of it is he kind of creeped around the corner. Hey, Jesus, let me know. I can tell that you are a man of God. There is no doubt in my mind. I understand the whole total picture of that. But there's something different, and I need to know what that is. Help me to get there. And Jesus told him, you got to be born again. That's his choosing. To either accept his Pharisaical teaching or hear the word of God and receive that new birth by way of spirit that God could work with him. It's a choice he made. And from all accounts, I don't see where he didn't make that choice. Then you might say, well, so what? That's people, families. One of the families that I believe he affected mostly. And someone go there, and I want you just to read that and see how they went with that. John 1:41. Somebody find that and read it out if you like.
He first found his own brother Simon, said to him, we have found the Messiah, which is translated for Christ.
Wow. Jesus had just called him, by the way. What did he first go do? Found his own what? Who? Wow. Well, why didn't he go out and, you know, start? He found his own brother. It's a reason for that. That's why we work so hard in trying to establish the families that we do. And that's why Sonny has brought those messages to us in sequence about family and building in your family. Because it first starts with you, then it starts with your family, and then you can work your way out to the community. But let me tell you, there may be some opposition in the family. That's what we don't. There's another one of those. What am I going to choose to do when there's opposition? When the kid ain't cooperating? What am I going to choose to do then? That's where we had a problem. But you're hoping that your life and the way you're choosing to make your decisions in life are affecting your kid. And to be honest with you, sometimes we don't see it right away. I just had a thought today. We went down yesterday, drove down to Prairie du Chien, is that what they call that, dear? We saw these people we knew, and when we saw their kid, when he was first born, he was about this big. When we saw him that time, what did you know what you said? Oh my God, he has grown. She saw a difference. Our families need to see us grow that same way too. I know what my dad used to be like, but this is what my dad is like. Oh my God, he has changed. Steve, what has gotten into you? I went over to the Baptist church. No, that's not it. But anyway, people need to see that in us. They need to see the growth spiritually. Do they see it in me? I'm going to tell you, I have some lovely stories for Culver's. I really do. I have some wonderful stories for Culver's. It's just a blast. I have never, ever in my life worked a job that I enjoy so much. Don't pay much. But God is blessing. I have a whole entire family that God has crossed my path with them. And he's made it clear. I think I heard you say last week. I'm not jumping, but I heard you say last week. God gave you some people to deal with. You said I kind of missed it. God gave me a whole family to deal with. I ain't missing it. I'm not missing it. Do I know in total what's going to happen? I do know there are a few people I can rely on. I can go to my trusty prayer person named Dottie and throw up a name or two, and Dottie will pray like crazy. I'm not saying she's going to change them, but I do know I can entrust her with information that she will go out and actually deal with it. But here's what gets me most. When the little ones tell me, I love you. These kids, I don't know. When little kids come up and tell you, I love you, are you leaving? Wow. Heart. Whew. I go, ooh. Ooh. Or the grandma come in and said, oh, my grandchild was so disappointed last week. She was just not right. I said, well, why? I'm thinking, what did I do? You weren't here. Really? God's speaking the whole time. Guess what? Other voices are calling out saying, hey, no joke. God has a plan for us if we make the right choices to change our lives first, to deal with our families, no matter the situation. Kid gone, backslidden, I don't care what it is. God still wants to work in the family. Just heard a good report from sister back there. Gary and Missy hadn't talked to his daughter in 12 years. God's doing something now, ain't he? Huh? Maybe didn't do it when you thought he should do it. He's moving now. And then, of course, we know of Joshua, who says as far as he's concerned, who is going to serve the Lord? Just him? Him and his what? Whole house. Could he make them follow? Could he choose for them to follow? It's your choice. It's my choice. It's your choice to follow Christ daily. It's your choice to believe that he's with you every day. And if God's with you, guess what? You're going to find favor. I don't care what you do. I don't care what it is. Flipping a burger, being a doctor, being an athlete, being a truck driver, just being a mom, just being a dad. God's going to prosper you if you believe that he is with you. Not prosper in monetary ways. I'm talking about the spiritual life that we so desire, that we missed out on with that Adam and Eve had experienced. Wouldn't you like to experience that time they had with God? Nothing to block them. Nothing. They could go talk to him anytime they want. It's like those teenagers used to come to your office and you gave an open door. You can come see me what? Anytime you want. There's a girl that works with me right now. Say, I love Miss Bauer. She was in your office a lot. To me, that was like, whoa. Still affecting people and he ain't even here. So to change, we see what Joshua said. And we really don't need much reference to scripture other than Matthew 28, 19 to 20, what God commanded us to do. Go preach where? Go preach where? Some places? A little bit of places? All what? Now, what I did not want to, or what I did not tell you about Mr. Joseph is this. When Joseph started out his ordeal in Egypt, let me tell you something. He had no clue what God was going to do for him. He had not a clue. You cannot tell me that he came from that pit thinking, I'm going to change this nation. I'm going to change my lifestyle. He just rolled with what God had. And as he rolled with what God had, his life changed. Because if it was me and you did to me what his brothers did to him and I had the opportunity to face up with you again, it wouldn't have been pretty. It wouldn't have been nice. But guess what? God said the devil meant it for bad, but God's plan was to make it work for the good. And it's all in that he kept recognizing that God was with him. If you don't remember anything, remember tomorrow morning when you wake up, the decisions and choices you have to make. God is with you, good or bad. Oops. God is with you. When? All the time. No variance, no changing in him. He's the same today as he was yesterday, and he will. Doesn't sound like he's telling me that I take time off. He doesn't. So as you prepare yourself this week, be encouraged. If you have choices, decisions, you go through a test, remember, God is with you. And there is a way of escape. Sometimes we don't believe that. Always a hatch door that God shows you to get out of. So, I guess I'm done. I did it the way I believe God wanted me to do it. I may not have been like all the other guys who preach, but I don't really care. Not, I don't really care about you. I mean, I don't really care if I did it under the pretense of what you might call. But I believe God wants us, again, to just simply understand we have to believe that he's with us. If you don't, you're toast. You're done. You're laughing? You are. You're toast. You seriously, you are. If you don't believe he's with you, you're done. Any situation we get in, you're done. Simply put, and he just showed me, I'm going to wake you tomorrow morning, and we're going to have some choices. And I'm going to have to deal with those. And hopefully I'll deal with them with God, knowing that he's with me. Thank you.